Thank you very much for joining us here today for the Imaginations Factory Imagine series. As you know, we're going to be taking a light-hearted look at a couple of decades of, as Clive describes it, mucking about in design. So he's going to be talking about his time as a freelance consultant in London and an in-house designer. And then, of course, most of you will probably know him from his time as creative director of Samsung Design Europe, where he set up the studio with Mark Delaney and took it from a kind of purely industrial design studio to a much more complete, advanced user experience and innovation and research consultancy. And he was instrumental in promoting European socio-cultural sensitivities into an Asian culture, in this case, of course, Korean culture. And that's what his talk is about today. It's called East Meets West, and we're looking forward to finding out more. Before I introduce Clive, there's just a couple of things. As you've probably noticed, and as is kind of the thing we do these days, we're recording this session today, and we'll be posting it online. So if any of you have any problems with that, you'll have to leave now, I'm afraid. And also, please pop any questions you may have or any comments into the chat, and I'll pick them up, I'll grab them, and we'll do a Q&A session at the end of Clive's talk. But without further ado, Clive, thank you so much for joining us. Really looking forward to this. So, over to you.
Brilliant. Well, thanks for that introduction. I mean, you've taken most of my slides already by that intro. Fantastic. So I don't have to do a few of them already. That's basically what he just talked about. That's basically me, that lovely picture on the right-hand side, without any hair, unfortunately, like I am now. Okay. When Tristram kind of contacted me, I was going to do much more of a kind of general talk, but he seemed to be very interested in the East meets West and the kind of cultural differences of my kind of 14 years at Samsung. So I've put this together. I'll put my hand up straight away. I did a very similar talk like this many, many years ago. So I've updated this and added a few more bits and bobs into it. But anyway, okay. So what I'm going to talk about now is the impact of culture. The theme of cultural differences concerns anyone who meets people from outside their own narrow circle. By the way, I'm reading from left to right here. I'm a typical designer, which is slightly dyslexic, so I forget things very quickly. I've written all this down, it is my words, so if I'm looking to one side, it just means I'm looking at this kind of auto cue that's going up. Anyway, okay. So yeah, the theme of cultural differences concerns anyone who meets people from outside their own narrow circle. And in the modern world, this means virtually everybody. Until recently, the impact of culture was not well understood. This talk hopefully illustrates the impact of considerations can have based. I'm now going to move on to this one here. This basically just shows some of my kind of street creds, where I kind of started from and where I've kind of come to. So you can see on the right hand side, I started off at Seymour Powell, the kind of mad kind of bike guys, and then kind of moved my way through. Some of these companies don't actually exist anymore. I mean, FM Design doesn't, and nor does PSD. Some of those have amalgamated into other companies. But you can probably see from here that I've kind of jumped in and out of Samsung twice. So back in 97, 96, and then obviously back more recently, 2000 to 2014. The first time I was in Samsung was with Mark Delaney, and Clive Grignier was the head of the office. And that all kind of fizzled out when the big kind of crash happened in Korea. And then we can went off into different avenues, myself and Mark. And then we both reformed again back in 2000 when Samsung, when we set up the first studio outside of Korea, basically. Anyway, cool, excellent. My experience has spanned such diverse projects as trains to baths and kind of mobile phones. My eclectic background of kind of furniture, graphics, silversmithing and industrial design training have been a great asset. I think that's really important. I teach in college at the moment, and I think the more kind of broader kind of spectrum of kind of training you can get, I think really, really helps now in this kind of broader world of design, whether we're industrial designers or physical industrial designers or physical product designers or whatever. Firstly, I'll start with this little diagram. It's quite a fun little one, this one here, hopefully. So on the right-hand side here, we have Ross Lovegrove. And on the left-hand side here, we have Jasper Morrison. So obviously Ross kind of epitomizes kind of expressive organic, and Jasper Morrison kind of epitomizes an emotional minimalism. And the only reason I've put this little diagram in here is that design is quite cyclical. So 1 year or a couple of years, it'd be more organic, then it will go more towards minimalism and back and round again. So past, future, present. It's quite a fashion orientated kind of industry. And the reason I put this in is you'll see some with some of the slides I show next, the kind of varied and kind of wild and wacky stuff I've been up to. So, this first one here is just Seymour Powell. So obviously this is 89 to 91. So some pretty mad stuff here, from the Intercity 125 top left to Cindy's car, which is, I think, based on a Peugeot 205 hot hatchback. Here we have kind of FM, so a bit later on. Still, you have things like kind of Samsonite cases, attaches case, kind of map furniture. And then we have PSD, which again moves on again. The interesting one here is the one in the middle here, which looks like a monitor and computer. And again, this is the prequel to kind of the iMac. This was Fujitsu at the time, but obviously Apple made the proper iMac. I mean, you see it's got a floppy drive in this one, so it gives you some idea of dates and times. And the top one is quite interesting as well, which is Curva rubber made. It was the first one of these particular types of boxes ever produced. So the red and all the design of that was the first of these boxes. We see these boxes everywhere now. And again, now we go on to kind of Samsung. So this is the first Samsung kind of iteration for a year or so, maybe 2 years. And you can see here, it's very, very organic. I mean, this is really the epitome of when everything was really, really organic at that particular time. I mean, I could have showed you many, many different ones, but there's a few ideas of things, anything from microwaves to TV monitors, to vacuum cleaners, to the little kind of crab thing in the middle here is a floppy drive, which went with, no, it's a CD drive, which went with the TV, which is the top left, but really crazy organic stuff. I mean, in those days, we couldn't really draw these in CAD as in 3D, they had to be 2D. And myself and Mark would go down to the workshop, which is in Tring, and actually physically carve these out of foam and give this to the model maker and say, look, can you produce this out of chemi wood? So quite interesting times. And then moving on to Fitch, where, there's things like Ford Focus up there. I worked on some of the interior of that, or stuff for Jaguar or BT at the time, kind of decked phones, which were kind of super robust. I think this one was for a garage use. Looks a little bit like Teletubby, I must admit now, but that's another thing. And then Native. So yeah, I was a partner at Native. So you've got things like B&W speakers. You've got the, in the middle here, we have decked phones, which are also walkie-talkie. So for the police service, in fact, they still use the central one actually. It's a slight different variation, but the police service still and the fire service still use that phone that we did a long time ago. And again, you've still got Samsung on the right-hand side. I used to take the client with me. So when I went from one consultancy to another, the client would usually follow me anyway. And I think that's probably why back in 2000, when we got to kind of, well, it's Tangerine. Mark was working at Tangerine at the time. So again, we were still working for the client. So I think that's probably back in 2000 why Samsung actually approached us again, which will be this one here. So I'm going to move on to this page now. At the time, SDE was a medium-sized and expanding multidisciplinary design studio with a large corporate entity specialized in advanced social cultural UX research. I think Tristan said this. SDE focused on social cultural influences for the future and what this may mean for design. We used to call ourselves a in-house consultancy. The reason we call it in-house consultancy, unlike kind of Philips at the time, we had to justify everything we did. So we'd have to put through proposals, we'd have to put through kind of ideas of costs, and then we'd have to pitch back to the main company, and we wouldn't always win the pitches. So even though we were salaried, we still had to pitch for every particular job. And that meant we would work with people like Ross Lovegrove or Jasper Morrison or Philip Stark or other big names, as well as consultancies like Seymour Powell or whatever. So there was all this, and also in-house teams as well, in-house as in career itself. So a lot of mix of stuff. So we actually worked as a consultancy, believe it or not, even though we were salaried. Quite a weird kind of situation. Okay, what's the next one? So that's the kind of work we were doing then, back in, you know, between 2000 and 2014. So I could have put many, many things, but I just put some here. Anything from, I think, robot vacuum cleaners to upright vacuum cleaners to MP3 players. I think this MP3 player here was, I think the iPod was coming out, and this was a very similar time as the iPod. And kind of a washing machine right in the middle there, and that, which is an interesting one, because in Korea they have a premium brand called Hausen, House Central, kind of German word. They don't have that anywhere else in the world, but in Korea they have a sub-brand called Hausen. And, you know, we often had to design the Western way for Korean products. So that has the magic space at the bottom. Anyway, I won't go into the magic spaces for it. Anyway, I talk about the past as an understanding of how I use my background experiences as leverage in promoting kind of European sensibilities within an Asian culture. Hopefully by the end of this presentation, you'll have shed some light and knowledge on how to bridge the gap and forge a more meaningful and working relationship. Okay, on to the main thing we're talking about today, which is East Meets West, the nurturing communication. So I'm gonna move straight onto this page here. This little diagram is quite interesting because it's like a little process diagram. And I think this helps explain a little bit of what East ethos and Western ethos is. On the left-hand side, we see the Design Council Double Diamond, and this is the uprated one. And, you know, to a certain extent, this is standard within industry, especially within the UK industry. And we all know how to use the double diamond. What's really interesting is that when you superimpose that over the kind of Eastern ethos, it's quite different. They basically have multiple double diamonds. So these kind of red triangles here is the whole of that process. And the way that they could have justified that is that if you've gone through all that double diamond once and something pops out at the end, there's no reason why you can't do it again and again and again. So at each pinch point here, quite often you throw away everything that you've done, the as in concepts, and you start again and you start again and again, and you go all the way down to there. So it sounds very wasteful, and to a certain extent it can be, because these are consultancies you may be throwing away, or design kind of specialists, or they can be concepts you're throwing away. Their idea being that if you've gone through the process, you've understood exactly what it's all about. So you can come up with lots of brand new stuff at, you know, just a flip of your fingers. So it's quite an interesting way of looking at two different design processes. Okay, cool. Okay, now I'll start posing the question. Okay, East and West cultures are obviously different. Yeah, what does this mean in design, and can one size fit all? Yeah, are we so differently that designers and cultures cannot communicate effectively, sovereignly? What culture drivers create rifts between our clients, and how can these be streamlined? How to translate European consumer interests, concretize, which is a lovely word, which is Korean English, business principles and multi-level communications. I'd love, there's lots of Kringlish, which I'll have to put a dictionary down of Kringlish at some time. It's good fun. Okay. This is a look, yeah. Where have we got? But firstly, a search for a plausible explanation to my contrasting points of view compared to my Korean colleagues. Were there some deeply rooted differences? And these little anecdotes are things which were given to me. So this one's a lovely one here. So in the West, if a shoe doesn't fit, buy a bigger shoe. In the East, you should cut your toes off. Added to that one, this is another lovely one. In the West, we look above the parapet. In the East, you're likely to be shot down. So lovely little kind of anecdotes of how they actually look, how they actually feel. In the next slides, explain more scientifically and a pivotal to understanding. They work as a backdrop to later answering the questions. Okay, so opposite cultures. What does high and context and low context mean? According to Floyd, many people deal with situations of conflicts depending whether the culture is either high context or low context. So here we have like a little map of the world. So you can see the low context cultures in the pinky color, and the high context and obviously in the kind of slightly blue color. So obviously, you know, a lot of the kind of Europeans are in the kind of the pinky color to a certain extent, not all Europeans. So what does high context or low context mean? For a start, this does not relate to the status. The general term high context and low context are used to describe broad brushstrokes, the cultural difference between societies. So on the right-hand side here, you can see some of the rules. Low context societies are loose, wide networks, short-term, compartmentalized relationships, task more important than relationship. Knowledge is above the waterline, explicit, consciously organized. And I think the best way to describe it is think of speed dating. And this is where we fit in within the low context. Obviously, high context is quite different. So if you compare that to high context, their societies are societies where people have dense intersecting networks and long-term relationships, strong boundaries, with relationships more important than the task. Aspects of cultural behavior are not made explicit. Knowledge is below the waterline, implicit. Patterns that are not fully conscious, hard to explain. Probably the best way to describe this is your family. Example of you, which is, yeah, of your family, basically. So how many building working relationships? How do we get some kind of harmony going? In the West, it's relatively easy to enter as an outsider in a new business situation because the environment contains much of the information you need to participate. You can form relationships soon. The important thing is accomplishing the task. We've all done this. However, in the East, it can be difficult if you're an outsider because you don't carry the context information internally and because you can't instantly create relationships. So, you know, what is the solution here? Well, try to understand the culture, way of doing business before going in as a bull in a china shop. Building friendships is crucial. It is not uncommon to have many business meetings before any signing on the dotted line. And a lot of business is still done outside of the office. So we used to get quite regularly different consultancies or organizations contacting us to do work with Samsung. And what we'd say to them is that, you know, you would have to fly over. You can't do it via a screen or telephone conversation. You'd actually physically have to fly to Korea. And you'd probably have to fly to Korea 3-4 times before you got anywhere and build these relationships. So it's going out for business meals in the evening and drinking together. So it would be very expensive to actually get work to start off with an Asian company. I hope this all makes sense. Managing expectations. Okay. The high context person may be frustrated by people appearing not to want to have long-term relationships to continue to help them on an ongoing and also to continue, sorry, I'm starting again, develop a relationship or continue to help them on an ongoing basis. So it is a very long-term business and relationship, and you have to keep working at it all the time. And there's many other things that which are not strictly business related, which you can help them with, whether it's to do with, you know, we used to help some people with photography and other bits and pieces, which weren't strictly related to our kind of business life, but it was part of the kind of friendship and making. They will expect small, close-knit groups and reliance on that group. They're used to difficulty in getting support outside the group. Professional and personal lives often intertwine. Being on a call for 24 hours, late or overtime is not an issue. So even when they went on holiday, quite a lot of the Samsung managers would be on call 24 hours. Part of the reason they were allowed to go on holiday was they had to have their mobile with them all the time. And it wasn't till recently that they went from a 7-day working week down to a 6-day working week. And of course, when we used to fly over to Korea, we would work, you know, 24/7. There'd be beds in the model shop, so you could actually sleep there while they did the work, and then they would wake you up when there was a particular color or whatever problem they'd have, and that's how it worked for a week or so. And all your food would be brought in as well, so you know your bedroom and your accommodation and your workspace is one of the same thing. Right, where? Cool. Right. So, solution. Culturally, the West puts family first. In the East, this can be somewhat different. When you understand the basic trait, you can imagine expectations. So it really is as simple as that. Family first for us, work first for them. Now, humour breaking the ice, a level field. As a Brit, irony is naturally comes naturally and forms a great part of our business life. But humour is very much about context, as a joke may not be considered funny if it seems it is overexplained. Consequently, I find myself kind of biting my lip quite regularly, actually, being quite cheeky most of the time. I'm showing Mr. Bean here, basically, that however, there is some humour that translates all languages and barriers, slapstick or farce. Mr. Bean is appreciating Korea. If you keep to humour, there's not linked to culture, context, all be well. And I think a lot of the way you use humour and the way you use kind of jokes and laughter, it's fantastic for doing kind of business because they have direct correlations. What's the next one? Market opportunity scenarios. Okay, Samsung announced years ago that its official business line, by the way, this links really nice with kind of farce and humor. Samsung announced years ago that its official business language was English. This is fine for most communication, but has limitations for finer points. And at the VP level, where English is not widely practiced. Now, PowerPoint is all good and well, but it falls down when you have a VP who has only 15 minutes for you to explain a 6-month project, which involves a deep understanding of consumer cultural background as well as final concepts. So we had a lot of fun where a VP would be in a meeting and we would start with a PowerPoint or whatever, start to explain a project. They would fall asleep and then wake up at the end of the project when the final concept was put on screen and they'd say, no, I don't like pink or I don't like ears on this product, not realizing that the whole product was designed for a 5-year-old girl and that whole world is about pink and animals with ears on. So we had a lot of problem with PowerPoint presentations or very still PowerPoint presentations. That's why we went for this multi-level communication. Solution, we use steel-o-matics. So we often a mixture of mixture of stock images and kind of stock footage techniques and live action film to show to internal audiences scenarios based on real life. We found that film crossed all barriers and is the quickest, most effective way for a VP to understand, for instance, the life, love and wishes of different cultures. So going back to the slapstick and the kind of Mr. Bean, which is all visual and not much words, exactly what we used to do as well. So we got into filmmaking. I think some of our films were shot in 3D towards the end as well. We could only shoot kind of non-kind of moving 3D because kind of Cameron and all of his other techniques about moving 3D rigs we hadn't got to. But we had actors, costumes, makeup, all of those bits and pieces. So actually what I'll do is I'm going to show you some of these movies now. Hopefully. If this works. Here we go. That's F, isn't it? Brilliant. So here you go. So this is like a mixed match of different things, whether it's live film or whether it's animated storyboards. But again, as it rolls through, you'll see some of the amount of rear production it was involved, whether it's train tracks, whether it is rostrums, moving rigs, actors. Anyway, I'll play it and you see what you think. Is the volume okay?
Perfect.
Thank you.
Fabulous. Brilliant.
Cool. Now I'm going to stop sharing and share again, I think, and then I'll have to go back into this. I've got to find it now. Here we go. Brilliant. We should be back in.
Yep. We're good to go.
Excellent. Cool. Okay. Yeah. I think multi-level communication rolls nice in storytelling. Kind of 17 years ago, it's fine to kind of produce beautiful solutions. Today, the same solution would not be acceptable. That's really true. Samsung were predominantly a hardware manufacturer, but the emerging manufacturing markets of China and India service is now at the forefront. And we've really seen that in the recent kind of times. So I always tell my students now that it's not about producing lovely things. It's about the story and how you can help marketing with that story and how marketing can then protrude that story to the customer. Mm. Okay. And this little diagram is probably really quite nice, actually. Aspiring premium companies need to produce holistic offerings with the story and provenance playing major elements. Provenance is really, really big at the moment. Mm. From the age of the Industrial Revolution, real invention has declined, but knowledge has increased. We may not manufacture much in the West. We don't manufacture much in this country, unfortunately. But it is in the intellectual reasoning and emotional realms where we excel. We can breach the alienation. We don't just do it, we ask why. And I think this little diagram more or less describes it. Most things have already been designed, or we're just making them better to a certain extent. Here we go. A little summary here before I show you some more of my stuff. Converging technologies and the disappearing income difference across countries does not lead to emerging of consumer behavior. Instead of consumer behavior becomes more differentiated because of cultural differences. So take Brexit, for instance. As consumer income converge across countries, the manifestations of contextual differences will become stronger. This makes it really important to understand the values of national cultures and their impact on consumer behavior. So this is really nice. We've got the Coke example down here. Big successes have come from markets where we read the consumer psyche every day and adjust the market model every day. And that's a direct quote from Coca-Cola. And I think the next ones, So the next ones are just basically what I've been doing recently. So my little agency, which is mainly myself and lots of friends, we do a bespoke agile innovation design service, serving our clients' needs, desires, values, business, consumers. I suppose the way it's really difficult now because I used to call myself a product designer, but of course product design now with the kind of emerging markets of UX is now really industrial design or physical product design. There's a bit of that weird thing going on at the moment. You can see that within all the kind of adverts you see in Design Week or whatever it is for product designers. You kind of click on it and realize it's actually more UX based. The kind of clients I work with at the moment are kind of varied mix, whether it's IKEA or kind of Mac motorcycles or whatever, Staple Spoon or surgical stuff. And just a few kind of examples here of some of the stuff that I've been doing. A nice little device here. This is a ophthalmic device for looking at contact lenses. You put a contact lens in the kind of in the bottom of this unit here with a saline solution. And it uses a laser to actually interrogate that contact lens to check whether it's not check it's real, because there are a lot of counterfeit contact lenses out there, but also check how it's been manufactured, whether it's a bifocal, varifocal contact lens, and what kind of strength it is. And a lovely little project because the company is a really old company, you know, 1970s. Most of their stuff looked like kind of microfiche machines, you know, kind of big black boxes, which used lights rather than lasers. And some kind of guy would have to twiddle something on the side and push two points together to measure the kind of contact lens. But of course, as I said, contact lenses are not just about thicknesses anymore. They're about how, you know, all the different varivocals and whatever is going on. So this little device does that. What's interesting thing about this, the bed could be changed. So they also do contact lenses for lions and tigers as well, which is quite fun. In captivity, they often fight, scratch each other's eyes. So a contact lens is produced to put over their eyes so it heals correctly. But anyway, going back to the Optimec, I mean, they were very old fashioned 70s company. We did the branding. We did, well, everything to do with the company, the new colors, new branding, new vision, new products. And they've done very, very well. I think they had 11 products. This was one of them. And this one product, I think, doubled their turnover with one product. So yeah, doing very nicely, in fact. A product which I've been working on for about 5 years now, ridiculously, I know, but it's difficult. But Mack Motorcycles is a brand new British manufacturer of motorcycles. I mean, we've just launched the bike bottom right. It's not quite finished, but it's taken 5 years. So you can imagine producing any vehicle with all the rules and regulations nowadays is a nightmare. I mean, it started off with an air-cooled Buell engine. Because we've taken so long, the emission regulations have changed so much that you can't have air-cooled full stop. Ducati can't. Harley-Davidson can't do it, so we couldn't. So we had to change to a water-cooled. So some things have changed as the years gone by. But the top right is a rendering, and then the bottom left is, you know, the bike. I mean, it's missing the fly screen, but a lot of crazy CAD towards petrol tanks and lots of bits on it. But anyway, not a nice little product. And again, the last one I'm going to show, there are more, but the last one I show is a little startup project. This was produced as a Kickstarter project. And I think he stopped it after 3 days because it got ridiculous. I mean, I think he got 66,000 within 3 days and thought, well, that's enough. That's all I need. Hired me to basically to produce this little unit here. And it's a lovely little thing. It's just, it's basically a little frame, and you can use these kind of guards to zoom in on your 35mm or large format film. And it helps you digitize your old slide film back to back to digital format as such. There are many apps that you can reverse the film out, so from negative to positive. And of course, this little device can go flat on a bed as well. And you use an SLR with a frame, and the results are absolutely amazing. You can get, you know, it's as good quality as the slide film, but obviously it's digital now. And that's basically it, really.
Wonderful. That's fabulous. Thank you so much. That's absolutely brilliant. I've got a few observations and actually some questions for you. But I will invite everybody to put their questions into the chat so we can relay them and ask them to of Clive. But you brought up a number of things there. I've made a few notes, as I always do. I mean, that thing about multidisciplinarity, or if that's a word, like breadth as a designer, I think, is a really key thing. And I would say it's a shame that a lot of designers, there's less and less that do foundation courses. I think there was a reduction in the numbers doing foundation courses as a diagnostic thing to really understand if somebody was good at drawing or making, what was the outlet? How do you sort of manifest your sort of innate creativity and desire to make things and produce things and solve problems and all that kind of stuff? But which area of design do you put it into? So I think that, I mean, doing a foundation course is a great thing to give you a bit of exposure to the other things, but it also gives you, in my experience, I did a foundation course, but it actually left me with this desire to remain quite broad and to not just kind of focus too much. And I think it's an important thing. And I think for our times, it's increasingly important to do that. So I'm really glad you brought that up.
I mean, I did a BTEC actually. Which was obviously a 3-year. I went in thinking I was going to be a graphic designer. I found it too 2D at the time. I mean, obviously graphics are now 2.5D, with screens. Mm-hmm. I started off as a graphic designer. I also did silversmithing. And realized actually, no, it's going to be, you know, furniture or product. So I did a furniture product degree and then finished off in product. So yes, I mixed them out around, but it gave me that breadth. If you do a foundation, you can understand, is this right for me or is this not right for me, basically?
One other thing that, as you know, I've worked with a lot of Japanese clients in the past, and I think I benefited from that basic. I didn't realize it at the time, but I studied Japanese a bit at school. And that really helped in a lot of ways, because it got me that first hurdle of, as with any non-English speaking company you might be working with, just knowing a little bit of their language for a start is a great icebreaker in itself. But then beyond that, to have be furnished with a little bit of understanding of some of the cultural things that go in and around that has really helped. So certainly I've seen lots of occasions or heard of lots of stories where, and indeed colleagues that I've worked with that haven't had that sort of experience of working with, in my case with Japanese Japanese clients, it helps so much to have that bit of heads up and that cultural kind of a bit of orientation. Often I found didn't seem to happen enough. I think I was personally fortunate to have that. However, when I worked with LG Japan team, and then I had to work with the LG Korea team, completely different story.
Yeah.
And that's where you realize, of course, you can't say that Eastern culture in a broad sense is going to be the same, because of course it's not, as we all are probably aware. But that was a bit of a shock, because it's very different. It's like you say, you brought back, I nearly came out in hives when you were talking about sleeping in the model shop. I had that a few times, sleeping in the studio waiting for calls that could happen at any time of day or night, and indeed sometimes didn't happen. They'd missed them by 12 hours. It was very, very odd difference in experience with between Korea and Japan.
But as a young designer, I mean, it's different now. I mean, the students now expect and should have a different experience than when we were young designers. But of course, yeah. We used to sleep on bubble wrap underneath kind of benches and that, when we were young designers.
Yeah. And that thing about, you mentioned about the, I'd heard of that before, about the low context and high context culture.
Yeah.
I saw on your list that France is a high context culture. I didn't realize that, but that might explain, my wife's French, that might explain a lot.
Well, that's probably why we had a 100-year war. Yeah, exactly.
Could well be, our oldest enemy, I think they are. So yeah, that's interesting. I'm going to look into a bit more into that. So anybody out there who wants to put a chat or pose a question to Clive, please feel free to do that. Nothing coming through there.
Okay.
I can hear someone.
Hello. Hi, thank you so much. I'm sorry I was a little bit late coming in.
No worry.
But I just caught you, I caught most of your presentation, which was
Marta, hello.
Really, it's Marta, yes, sorry. It's really interesting for me. I learnt a lot, lots of things I didn't understand, but I'm not a designer and I'm not an engineer, but I've been doing some research and development on a product which is in between design and engineering. It's got design applications and engineering applications. And I love the multidisciplinary approach to things. But how do you find multidisciplinary designers? So I don't do any of the stuff myself. I've worked with brilliant designers and engineers. I just go on a gut instinct about, I think they're gonna come at it from a really broad base, as opposed to this is the way it's always done in this area. But how do you find these multidisciplinary art designers and engineers?
Well, myself, I mean, it was interesting when we first set up when I first set up the studio with Mark many, many years ago. We used to take on people that had a weird, not just design, by the way, but a big spectrum of knowledge. And those people, you could understand, you could pick these people out quite quickly, because they would ask vast amounts of questions.
Yes.
Which is great, because you need people to ask questions. So we would take on people. It's really weird, actually. We took on people which weren't the best people. So we saw some amazing people. But the problem with those, they're all prima donnas. We took on people that worked as teams. So we took on, I suppose the best way to describe it, a load of oddballs.
Yeah.
Having said that, all these oddballs have done incredibly well, and they're all in different countries. They're all heads of industry in different things. But these oddballs, they all spoke the same kind of language, which was basically they all used to ask questions, and they'd ask questions of each other. Yeah. And that really kind of gelled and worked together. So it's, you know, a good way of looking at it is CVs are fantastic, but asking about their background. We would do, when we used to interview people, yeah, we would do as before we started talking about anything to do about work, we would talk about their interests,
yeah,
and where they came from and what they aspire to.
Okay.
And that you it's really interesting what people say, and it really puts people at rest as well.
Yeah.
And then you talk about the work at the other end. I mean, it can go to extremes, by the way. We did interview one guy who's head of a very big design agency at the moment. We took him to Centrepoint in the middle of London for drinks. Mm-hmm. And in the morning, he rang me up and he said, did you offer me a job? Because I was a little bit inebriated. I can't remember. And I said to him, did you think we offered you a job? He said, yeah. I said, oh, yeah, then we must have done then. Do you want the job? He said, yeah, OK. And he was the first employee of Samsung.
Well, we're going to find out who that is.
That's easy. It's a well-known Welshman.
Oh. What's that for?
I don't know who that is. I do. So I'm one of those people that asks loads of questions because I'm coming from a position of real naivety. So I've not done things before. Everything I'm doing, I'm practically doing for the first time, learning as I go. But so I actually know that I can work with people who don't mind me asking questions and answer my questions in a way that I can understand.
There's lots of
no knowledge, you know, like I don't know. So they have to be able to explain it really simply so I get it. So asking questions is a good thing, but I've worked with loads of and I've met loads of different designers and engineers, and mostly I find that I go on a gut instinct. You know, I think that this person's going to be a lateral thinker, as opposed to telling me this is how it's always done and this is how, this is my approach because I'm trained and I know what I'm doing. So interesting. Well,
yeah, this is how it's always done is obviously the worst form of creativity.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Anyway, thanks for that.
That's fabulous. What you've brought into the conversation there. I've got a question for you, Clive.
Oh wow! Here we go.
What has been the strangest project that you've worked on?
Oh god. Strangest project I've worked on. Well, actually, I probably could do one of the Samsung ones have been strange, actually, because the Hausen one I talked about, which is their premium brand.
Yep.
So the Hausen is a made up word. Apparently in German, it means house central or house. Anyway, so it's a made up word for the Korean market, which sounds kind of German and premium, you know, that kind of idea.
Yeah.
And they approached us to design a range of consumer products, mainly appliances for the Korean market, but in a Western way. Well, that's all very well, but we don't have kimchi refrigeration. So we had to design kimchi fridges as if we had them in the West.
Yeah.
Which is quite weird, and the kimchi fridge is very odd. I don't, everybody knows kimchi now, but then it was quite new. And of course you can't store kimchi in a normal fridge with your other product because it taints it really badly.
Oh wow, okay.
It's incredibly
caustic. Powerful.
Yeah, it's that powerful. And of course kimchi in the traditional kind of Korean culture is fermented for many, many months in earthenware jars buried in the ground. So in the kimchi fridge it has to be regulated so it's still fermenting.
Okay, yeah.
So it's quite a weird product to design when you have no idea about kimchi and the culture. There's about 130 different kimchis.
I didn't know it's that many. That's amazing. I knew there were a few, but
it's a mad amount of kimchi. And of course kimchi in Korea is, you know, breakfast, lunch, dinner. It's, you know, it's all the way through.
Wow.
So it's quite a weird one when you know to understand all of that stuff.
Well,
that sounds
like it qualifies for strangest project. Could be a contender.
Yeah, I mean, there's always, what I like is when people give me stuff which I have no idea about, because that's brilliant, because then you have to learn something completely new. And they are the greatest projects, you know. If somebody says, oh, you know, do me another mobile phone, it's, oh, God, really? Another one?
Yeah.
You know, that those don't, you know, that, unless there's something really kind of, well, the problem with mobiles and the problem with TVs now, that's why I show in my presentation, I show lots of backs of TVs.
Mm.
In the old days, you could actually have some fun designing backs of things.
Well, they used to have a back, didn't they? They used to
have a back, yeah. Whereas a mobile phone now on a TV is screen, that's it. You know, there is nothing, you know, there's no design left as such, really. Mm. But anyway, hopefully that answers the question slightly weird.
I think it does.
Yes.
I've got another question for you. Hi, Clive. Great talk. This is from Bill. If you were to give one piece of advice to a young designer, what would it be?
Oh, well, I wonder if this is a young designer that's just starting out or somebody at college. If you're at college, I always give the same advice to everybody that's at uni, is have fun and be creative. So don't try and design something which you think will be acceptable to somebody outside. Yeah.
Mm.
So this is the time when you can be, you know, expansive, creative, mad, because that's the stuff I like to see, the fact where your mind's going. So if you're at college, that's what I would do. If you're out of college, what used to work, and hopefully it still does, is that you get yourself into a consultancy, hopefully, maybe it's consultancy or in-house, and you cut your teeth quite quickly. But you don't stay there for very long. You move on. You keep moving every 1 to 2 years to get experience, to get knowledge. And then by the time, you know, 3, 4, 5 years, you're really kind of completely rounded. And then you can see exactly where you want to go or where you want to go to, whether that's going off on your own or whether you're going to, you're targeting a particular wherever.
Mm. That makes a lot of sense. I think I'd agree with you there. Yeah, it kind of fast tracks you, doesn't it? And it gives you, you can eventually, it's how as a young, inexperienced person, let alone designer, you get to experience lots of different people working, ways of working, different cultures and all that, you know, studio cultures and all that kind of stuff. And excuse me, it helps you recognize what's good, what's bad, what's healthy, what's not, and you make heck of a load of contacts and build your network. So yeah, I think the earlier you can do that, I'd agree that.
Yeah, I mean, I've got a vast network of old farts. Yeah.
Goodness. Well, Clive, that was really great. Thank you so much for doing that. I'm really appreciative of that, as I think we all are. It's been great to hear you today, but it's been really lovely to catch up with you over the past couple of weeks as we sort of put this together, and I'm really, really glad that we're still in touch. We met years and years ago first at Native when we were working in the same space in London Street, and they were crazy days, but it's been brilliant to go through that little journey of how design has changed in the 20 plus years since that time, it's really good to still be in contact with you. So thanks again. Cool. We'll stay in touch, I'm sure. And
yeah.
When's the party? When are we all invited down to Falmouth to Cornwall for a?
Well, we are going to do a summer party here. This space here uses this is where the DJ is usually in.
Brilliant.
So we open up these doors here and have all the lights, and the DJ's in this part here with the speakers, and we open up the garden for a summer party. Yeah.
Oh, that sounds cool. Well, you know where I am. Great. Thanks ever so much again. That was brilliant. And we'll speak to you soon. So thank you very much, Clive Goodwin.